Just to show you a little bit of his personality, he was young but he had a mustache, so we nicknamed him Stash. So Tyler would be at the free throw line, he would bounce the ball twice, look over at the coaches and kind of just twirl his little mustache before he would take his free throw. That was just his personality and his character.
Tyler Matthew Bland was born April 8th, 2000. I had Tyler as a young mom. I was only 17 when I had Tyler. Tyler was such a good baby. He was calm, he was very loving. As he got into toddler stage, he was very independent. Even though, you know, I had a lot of support with my family, I solely was his only parent. Loved watching Bob the Builder. I really didn't understand why, but he had a little Bob the Builder, little doll somebody got him for Christmas one year, and you know, a little hat, little construction hat. And he was always watching older kids play, if they were kicking the ball or if they were out running around playing tag. He was always curious, but he was quick to make friends. We lived in Greenbelt at the time when he was born and up until he was 9. He taught me a lot, and I was still finished school. I worked full time. I went to school at night, and he was my full motivation. Hi, my name is Amanda Kirby.
And I'm Brendan Kirby, and this is the story of our son, Tyler Matthew Bland.
He was fun. He was, you know, he was that fun, wild, crazy. But
not just hanging out with his friends. He could be hanging out with just me and my buddies, grilling food and hanging out. You know, we'd let him have a couple beers every now and then, and he was funny. He was funny. He could hang out with adults and be funny.
Yes, he was very funny, but he could also be very serious too. I felt like when he talked with us, I knew that he cared for others. I don't know. Just the jokes. I mean, I miss the jokes. I miss the laugh. You know, his smile would light up a room. I don't know. Just, you know, to tell him 500 things for one thing, you know?
Definitely what we miss the most.
Hi, my name is Malcolm Brown.
I'm Jacob Hendricks.
And we just wanted to say a few words about Tyler Bland.
It was the first time I had a conversation with him. We were out at recess and he got in my face and bopped his head around and was singing the real popular Kesha song, something about taking a ride on a disco stick or something like that. So he was just a crazy kid, you know, hilarious, full of life, knew I had to be his friend. Like Malcolm said, you know, we started hanging out a lot, you know, weekly sleepovers, daily phone calls. He, you know, was crazy on the phone. He always had to be calling, not texting. He's always breaking his phone, so we had all of our numbers memorized.
We were laughing earlier. We would come over here and sneak out all the time. And I just remember we would be walking around Dares Beach at like 2 a.m. in the morning, just like, you know, kicking rocks around and just talking. And we'd end up coming in and Miss Amanda or Mr. Brennan are just sitting there like waiting for us. And just doing crazy things like that. We like to go up on the roof outside of his room a lot, and we get yelled at each time. And just doing crazy things like that. He was really full of life, and sports and things like that in school. Tyler really just had like a lot of friends. everywhere. You know, we played football, basketball. He did wrestling, I think. And yeah, he just had friends on all the teams. He was friends with everybody. Everybody knew him.
Full of life, a little bit of a maniac sometimes. But really just like the life of the party, like just like everywhere, always on, always cracking jokes.
God damn it. God damn it. And I don't mean that sacrilegious or anything, but just I'm mad. So fucking mad. And I'm so sad. And I just wish I could hug him one more time and just say everything will be okay. Because maybe I would have had the opportunity to do that, I just didn't know it. But I think he knew he was loved. I know he knew he was loved. I know he knew it. I know he knew it.
On May 12, 2016, we lost our son, Tyler Bland, who was a student, an athlete, a friend, and well-known, you know, by others in our community to suicide.
We still miss you every day, but everyone's doing a lot better now. Wish we could have helped you. Wish you were still here today. And it's impossible not to think about where you'd be and what you'd be doing. But thank you for being the person you were while you were here. The memory of you and how you lived life is the only thing that makes it better. Your life has and will continue to change the lives of many. I'm thankful to be a part of that.
If I could say one thing to Tyler, it would just be that I miss him, and I hope wherever he is, he's doing what he loves to do and that he's happy.
If I could say one more thing to Tyler, I think I would tell him how much I love him, and just to let him know that he's not alone and that, you know, there's so many people that love him so much.
If I could say one thing to Tyler, I would say that I'm just so grateful to have been a part of your life. You've truly impacted me in such a positive way, and I will forever be grateful for all of the memories we have shared, and I will cherish them forever. I miss you.
On that day, drove to the Kirby's house. When I got to the Kirby's house, I noticed there were a lot of people outside, and so that I knew that it was true. And I saw Brendan and Amanda, we hugged, and just were all in disbelief. It was almost like some sort of zombie apocalypse. No one knew exactly what to do. We were just standing there and thinking that it wasn't true. After an hour or so, I remember going home and still just, you know, talking to my wife, and, you know, I had to explain it to my son when he got home from school. And then social media became a buzz with what was going on and that they wanted to have a candlelight vigil for Tyler. So I came back, and it was just simply amazing. Car after car after car after van pulled up. And within a matter of hours, there were hundreds of people outside. And everyone was just standing around and, you know, telling stories and talking. And it seemed to help the mood. But what was amazing to me was Tyler's mom, Amanda. She was hugging people and walking and talking and comfort. And she was comforting everybody in the crowd. You know, I can't imagine what she was going through, but her strength was simply amazing. Later on that night, people began to light candles, and I remember Amanda's aunt or someone came to me and asked me, would I pray? And I, without thinking, I said yes, not knowing exactly what I was going to pray about, but I did. I think that God put the words in my mouth that needed to be said. The kids were crying, and I was letting them know that Tyler was looking down on us. And I remember I asked people to twirl their hair like Tyler would always do, so that you had hundreds of people standing there twirling their hair, holding their candles. And the only thing I could think of is if he could have just held on a little longer to see the hundreds of people who loved him, who came out that night to let them know, let him know, Tyler, we love you, we're here for you. But at that moment, I guess he saw no other way out. So after that, you know, we continued to love on the family. We still love on the family. That day will always go down in infamy because it was the day that I lost a really good player, friend, young man. We lost a great young man in Tyler Blanton on that day.
I wasn't really picking up on like sound. I was just hearing things and like Tyler, you know, a whole bunch of words, blah, something, 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 you know, why is he not? And then that's when my brain was running. I was like, why are they bringing up Tyler? You know, this is like the second person I walked past that brought up Tyler. I was like, he didn't come to school today. Why is he still, you know, the talk, you know? It wouldn't be surprising because he's popular, but why is he still the talk? And then one of my our close friends, Tristan, I saw him sprint down the hallway and I didn't really get a glimpse of his face, but it was down and it was like, it was a run. And then I started hearing things about Tristan and Sergey and crying. And I was like, okay, what's this all leading up to? And I saw Gil standing outside his room and he was holding the door, but all the lights were off in his room, which is odd because normally we're hanging out and, you know, all the lights were off in his room. And I didn't really get, you know, peek into the room, but it was just all dark. And like walked up to him and I was like, Gil, you know, what's going on? And he just like, he didn't really get to say, like, he didn't say anything. He just like kind of grabbed me by the back of my neck, like he always did when he was like trying to, you know, he just brought me in. And I can still I hadn't really understood what was going on. But the second my face like hit him, like it was a little, you know, bigger of a guy. So I slumped, like it came into him and I just felt like, you know, my ears get red. And I didn't even know why yet. It was just my ears got red, you know, my neck hair started sticking up. I was like, all right, what's going on? And that's when he was like, hey, you know, Tyler didn't come to school today. He ended up passing away, killing himself. And in that moment, I think everything froze. It just, I sat there for probably 5 minutes. And I don't even know if I had started crying yet. At that point, I'm just sitting there. I probably had tears coming down my face, but I hadn't really sobbed. I wasn't sobbing. It hit. Like, my body reacted before I really could. And so I sat there, and then the bell had rung, and I'm still sitting there. And I'm like, ah. So he grabbed me and just pulled me into his room, closed the door, and I had seen there was other, like, wrestlers and football players who he had also told, and they were all in there. And I guess while he was trying to figure out what was going on, we all had sat in there and lights were off. I sat at a desk with my head down and it was silent in that room. None of us could talk to each other. It was just, well, it wasn't silent, it was sobbing. But like none of us could even bring a word to each other.
I think for me, even though I know that Tyler can, his energy is still very strong and he's still here. That's my firm belief. And I know that he hears me. However, if he was here and present physically, I definitely would tell him, you know, I would tell him so much. I would hug him and I would tell him, you are loved. And I'd be, you know, so happy to speak with him. And, you know, I would just love to just hear a story from him. Whether even if it's a BS story, I don't care. You know, the arguments, the petty stuff, I don't care. I would relive all that all over again 1,000 times. Just to be here to have another conversation with him. I think the most part would be to tell him that I love him. I love him so much. And that I'm proud of him. I was always proud of him, but I'm proud of him.
I think if he was here, I'd tell him that it's going to be okay and that I love him. It's going to be okay. Just relax. Tomorrow's another day.
My name is Riley, and I'm Tyler's cousin. I want to read a poem my teacher gave me when Tyler passed. She had held on to it for many years after losing her daughter, and I've had it with me ever since. When somebody dies, a cloud turns into an angel and flies up to tell God to put another flower on a pillow. a bird gives a message back to the world and sings a silent prayer that makes the rain cry. People disappear, but they never really go away. The spirits up there put the sun to bed, wake up the grass, and spin the earth in dizzy circles. Sometimes you can see them dancing in a cloud during the daytime when they're supposed to be sleeping. They paint their rainbows and also the sunsets and make the waves splash and tug at the tide. They toss shooting stars and listen to wishes. And when they sing wind songs, they whisper to us, "Don't miss me too much. The view up here is nice and I'm doing just fine."
Probably some conversations that I should have had with him leading up to that. And didn't get the chance, but I wish I had. And their conversations, topics that my dad didn't have with me, and I'm sure his dad didn't have with him. It's kind of that push everything down in the way of emotions, shake it off and keep moving. And I think a lot of dads need to have conversations about mental health with their sons. And I think even talk to your son's friends about it. A lot of guys think that being a man's man is, you know, not wearing your heart on your sleeve and putting everything out there so people don't get a read on you or think you're weak. And it's a huge misconception. You can tell people how you feel and put everything out there on the line, and nobody's going to judge you for it. But if you need help, then there's places you can go to get help. So have that talk.
A hard time finding resources too. Like, there's, you know, the suicide hotline where you can call. You hate talking on the phone, there's a suicide text line. There's someone on the other end of the phone. You text it. This is what's going on. And just, like, even finding resources, like Psychology Today is a really good resource. You just plug in your county, what you're looking for, your insurance. Like, there are providers out there. You know, finding someone to talk to. And if you have a bad experience, go to another one. It's not a one-size-fits-all.
Sometimes you have to find somebody you click with.
Yeah.
That's just like a doctor. I mean, it is a doctor.
I mean, it's like all of us having a conversation. We're all having this conversation because we're all somewhat, even different walks and areas, we're all come together for one thing, but we're all comfortable being able to talk to each other. It's making someone else comfortable that says, okay, you want to put it in words? Text it to me. I'm going to check on you later. I'm going to call you later. I'm going to be there for you. I mean,
absolutely.
I do say, and I know that I've said this to you all, to everybody. I've said it to people that I don't even know. I don't care if you overhear it or if somebody says it to you, you know, or if you think they're joking. You need to say something, because I don't care if they get upset or not, because it's not a joke. And they need also, I mean, if they say, oh, it was a joke, well, they need to understand that it's not a joking matter, you know. And I think that was one of our lessons, you know, 5 years ago, that, you know, hey, if you overhear something, if you see something, or, you know, maybe let's say something, mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's like we almost think of the immediate. If I tell their mom, they're going to be mad at me. But it's a bigger picture.
Who cares if they're mad?
Who cares? They can be mad at you. It's okay. You know, and I think we all see from this experience, like, how it affected us and it changed my outlook on everything, and it's making me live a different life.
I think it changed all of our outlooks.
Yeah.
I mean, we're 5 years later and we're all looking to do something better, to give something back. Tyler was such an amazing, smart, athletic, fun, just whole heart, loving kid that gave so much to each of us, and each of us in a different way. And here we are. Let's do something. Let's make this better. Let's give it back. Let's save somebody else from going through what each of us have gone through.
This past year, it's been 5 years since Tyler's been gone. And time has no meaning. I just, you know, 5 years have gone by and I'm like, it's like you blinked and where did it go? You know, there's some days where, I know for me, I really crave for my son to walk through that door. And it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. You know,
still to this day, 5 years later, my daughter moved upstairs to the bedroom upstairs, and I walk past his room every day and I look in there and he's not there. He's not a 21-year-old kid that should be going to college or doing a trade program or a career, because I always wonder, what would he be doing now? You know, even though I know in my heart there's something else other than this life here, and I know he's doing big things. However, it still hurts. It hurts like hell, you know, and for anybody that sees this or sees these videos, you know, coming from somebody that has lost somebody to suicide, I mean, a survivor is a survivor as far as a lost survivor. And it hurts, you know, and if I could tell everybody, you're loved and you mean something here, you mean something in this world, and this world is not a better place without you. Yeah. Everybody has a purpose and everybody is a piece to somebody's puzzle. And, you know, we can all come together as, you know, a community, our school system, families, and talk about mental health openly, talk about anything, all cards on the table, you know, and it should be taken seriously. More and more, it seems like it's happening.
Yeah, and I don't know if it's because we lost Tyler that we notice it more now, if it's actually happening more. I think actually the statistics show that the rate of suicide is up, and it goes up every year. It's becoming more and more prevalent in society. And I think that opens the channels for people to talk about it more, but not in every instance, not in every community, not in every school system. I think it's something that people need to have conversation about, and it needs to be maybe a topic of discussion even amongst a certain age group of kids that are in school.
Well, why, I mean, you know, and I think that's absolutely true, because they talk about so much other stuff in the school systems.
They talk about health. Health is a course of study in middle school and high school, and mental health is part of your health. It's part of your well-being. It should be something that you're talking to these kids.
Well, we talk about, you know, don't do drugs, don't do this, don't be out here driving on Route 4 crazy, you know, when we're teaching our kids how to drive. Why can't we talk about this? Why? You know, to me, as a mom, you know, I always connect with other, you know, I truly do connect with other, I've met so many other parents that have lost their children over the years, and it doesn't matter no matter how they passed. And you always have these connections, and I can tell you, those women have been, you know.
Well, and some families don't fare as well in the aftermath as we've had.
No.
We've had an awesome support system. Family, friends, community, everything.
Obviously, Tyler is one of my closest friends that I've had on this whole earth, and, you know, going through something like this, I mean, I would never wish anything like this to happen to anybody, and that's kind of just what I want to talk about, is just, like, breaking that, like, silence and just letting people know that it's, like I said before, it's okay to not be okay, you know, and I feel like as a young man, we go through a lot of hardships and we try to play it off as we're okay, because that's not the cool thing to do. You know, it's we don't go through pain, we don't show emotion when that's not the case. I mean, everybody goes through stuff, and I feel like it's especially harder on young men because they get this false sense of I need to be tough and strong, when, you know, it's okay to show other people what you're going through so you can get better and lean on your support system. And I feel like that's just needs to be just needs to be heard more. And I feel like just getting the word out there that it's a serious issue and it needs to be talked about more.
Right, and I would also see, I see you guys throughout the community and the brotherhood, the bond that you guys still have whenever you see each other, you guys embrace and your communication, you guys actually talk on the phone, not just text each other and try to get together as much as you can. So I definitely know that you guys, it's been 5 years now and you guys are closer than ever. And I know that you guys know how much it means to Amanda, because you guys show up, you love on her, and you know that's something that's really to be commended for young men to not only think about themselves but to think about, you know, their brother's family. And I see how Bree, you know, how she just, you know, you're Uncle Dom, you know, mm-hmm. So she absolutely loves you. So, you know, it's nice to see young men being showing that emotion and loving up on others besides their own parents. Be commended. Great young man.
Kids go, and I've just never seen people. Maybe I didn't notice it because I was a kid then. Maybe. I don't know. But I don't know. Out of such a tragedy, it seems like something beautiful has happened. And even with this taking place and somebody, people coming together and trying to bring awareness to this, is it's not just about our kid. Mm-hmm. It's really not. So
no, it's not. It's about kids. It's about people.
It is. It's about people.
It's about people.
It's not just about the youth. It's about people.
It's about people in general.
To get another one, but my most favorite time is when we were outside. It wasn't even snowing. We're in the sled dragging me around, thinking it's funny when people that drive by are looking out their windows like, "Who? What are they doing? It's not snowing." But a moment that like I was mad about with him is when him and his friend Dominic took me and put me in a bucket and it was snowing outside. They took me to that big hill, rolled me down. I went through the road back into the front yard and this big snowplow truck honked the horn, and then people were standing there like, "Is she okay?"
What are some of the things that you guys kind of like to do together?
Be silly, mess around, I would say eat food, and mess with all his friends. And that's really it about what we would like to do together.
What are the things that you liked most about him?
That he was a funny person.
Do you have a nickname for you?
Bree, Rat, Brat.
Were you guys really close?
Yes.
How good of a brother was Tyler to you?
A very good person and brother.
You know, showing parents what some warning signs are. Did you guys have any warning signs looking back?
I think hindsight, you know.
There was a couple there.
You know.
Could you just kind of like list them just so that it's sort of straight?
The isolation.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't for long durations. It could just be a day. But he could be in his room all day, and it was not normal to not see or hear from him. He's a teenage boy, even to just come, not come down and tell you, "Hey, I'm hungry, what's for dinner?" That's, if you got a teenage son, and you haven't seen him all day, and he hasn't asked you, "What's for dinner?" I mean, looking back, I know when I was a teenager, I was eating around the clock. I think a lot of us can attest to that.
Or the fact that, you know, we'd go upstairs and, "Hey, what's wrong?" "Nothing. I'm just, you know."
sleeping.
I'm sleeping. I'm, you know. Yeah. I think for us too, you know, we went on, you know, just for a little bit. It felt like forever, but we kind of went on this, you know, behavioral roller coaster for a minute, and we knew it was out of character for him.
And to be honest with you, all adolescent and teenagers go through this, but it seemed like it. We had gotten to a level of normalcy, and things for a few weeks were like, okay, we're playing it out here. Things are looking up. Grades are coming back up. Attendance is back up. Try to stay ahead of the game, but you know, in the end, when we thought things were turning around and looking up, just blindsided, completely blindsided.
It was very blindsided. May 12, 2016 was something that I never expected in my life.
Yeah, the world definitely stopped turning for a while that day, for sure.
It did. I mean,
I bought a boat. I planned on giving him that when he graduated high school. I bought the boat with the intention of spending more time with him and getting his sister out there with us. And yeah, it's definitely not what I expected from my son. He was not reclusive. He was outgoing, athletic, good looking, popular with everybody at school. Not dealing with anything in our house that I feel like most parents with teenagers deal with. I think that was...
I mean, that was my question. Like, soon as all this was transpiring, where did we go wrong?
Right, where did it go wrong?
Where did it go wrong? What did we do wrong? And I know that parenting has there's no handbook. Nobody tells you what to do. You're learning as you go, and you know, and just the little things that, you know, we were dealing with, they seemed so big. And like Brendan said, we literally thought that things were turning around. I mean, it seemed like he was getting back to his old self. We weren't having to, you know, go back and forth, and it's just, I don't know.
Yeah, there was
no indications for us.
There was, yeah.
I mean, thought it never crossed my mind.
We weren't fighting. We weren't arguing.
The morning started out great. I knew I would be back for him. I mean, it just went total left. And those are things that you don't anticipate. Things can change in a matter of seconds.
Yeah.
And I don't know what happened, but why runs through my head still to this day every day. And I know that you shouldn't question why, but I can't. I just do.
It's hard for people to reach out for help, and I think we need to really change the conversation around that and letting people know that there is help out there. You aren't alone. You are loved. You are very important. And although in those moments of crisis where people may act impulsively in that moment, you know, that, you know, it does get better. It will get better. I think this is something that needs to be addressed on so many levels, you know, just even with social emotional learning, with young kids in school, learning to identify their feelings, learning to talk about it, having a safe place to talk about it, and also addressing this topic that is, you know, having such an effect on people of all ages, race, sex, you know, it doesn't discriminate. And it's something that people shy away from, I think, especially, you know, being in Tyler's family. I mean, this really, it rocked everyone's world. You know, it's still hard to wrap my mind around it sometimes. And, you know, I've been able to see the strength in Amanda and Brendan through, you know, their healing process and reaching out and bringing awareness to this. And I think it's such an important matter that people know that you know, their lives matter, and there's no shame in getting help, and things can get better.
The reason why we are speaking out about this today is because we feel like the conversation needs to be had. The conversation needs to be had in our schools. The conversation needs to be had in our communities. The conversation needs to be had in our homes. We are just parents of a child that is lost, that has been lost now. But it's so often now that we are hearing more and more about it. We need to break the stigma that surrounds mental health. Sometimes even adults, you know, in a place of an employment, I mean, it shouldn't just be a benefit. It should be made self-aware to your employees, to our groups.
Students.
Yeah, to students as well. We need to talk about it and make everybody feel comfortable. Nobody's comfortable unless the conversation is being had. That day, I don't think that Tyler really realized what was probably going to happen. He didn't want to die. However, it took his life that day. And I think at that moment of despair, because he was not, you know, not what you thought would be a person that was, you know, in a deep depression, or, you know, he was your typical teenager. And he was in a situation where he felt that that was all that it took it to. And it shocked us, and it shook us to our core.
And it shook the whole community.
And it did shake the whole community, because no one knew why. And we didn't, and we don't have the answers why. But, and I know that times are hard at this current moment that we're all living in, and I feel like that's more than ever we need to talk.
Yeah, I agree.
So
talk about it. Talk to your kids. Talk to your kids' friends. Talk to other parents. Bring it up.
For adults, I feel like, you know, I know we all take in so much, and, you know, we need to open up to each other. Whether it's at employment, whether it's with our kids, we need to open up and have that conversation. And for us, the lesson that we learned, and especially 5 years ago, if you hear something, if you notice something, say something to an adult, say something to anyone. Even if you feel like that person is joking or they could be serious, say something.
Yeah.
Who cares if they get upset?
If you're a young man, don't let your pride keep you from saying something to your parents or friends. That's another issue in itself. So you can tell somebody how you feel.
Loving and fighting, accusing, denying. I can't imagine a world with you gone. The joy and the chaos, the demons were made up. I'd be so lost if you left me alone. You locked yourself in the bathroom, lying on the floor when I break through. I pull you in to feel your heartbeat. Can you hear me screaming, please don't leave me? Hold on, I still want you. Come back, I still need you. Let me take your hand, I'll make you right. I swear to love you all my life. Hold on, I still need you. Long endless highway, you're silent beside me. Driving a nightmare I can't escape from. hopelessly praying. The light isn't fading, hiding the shock and the chill in my bones. They took you away.
Not to be okay. You matter always. Remembering Tyler and Bland and those who have left before us. Hashtag Team Bland.
Team Bland.
So, hopefully these work like they're supposed to.
Hey, oh my gosh!
I could say one thing to Tyler. It would be that he was able to create the man that I am today. And that I wish he was able to see who I can become in the future. I swear to love you
all my life. Please reach out. Please stop joking about the suicide. Please take every claim seriously. Be there for your friends, family, classmates, coworkers, and above everything else, know you matter, things will get better, and don't give up. Losing Tyler is one of the hardest things I've gone through, but it has made me want to advocate for suicide prevention every day of my life. I love you, Tyler, and I hope this documentary reaches at least one person who needs to hear this, but also honors you and makes you proud. Mama, come here, approach, appear,
Daddy, I'm alone. By Tristan, and I now nominate Dami Di Lodovico, Tony Sita, and Gino Sita. If you love me,
don't let go. If I could say something to Tyler, I would say, I love you, we miss you. Things aren't the same, and things will never be the same without you. You touch hundreds of lives, and you have brought people together, and what you're doing, we're never going to let that be in vain. We're going to use the pain and the suffering and the loneliness that you felt to make sure that we bring resources and hope to others. So, it was a pleasure knowing you. I miss you. I'm glad I was able to be your coach and be in your life. See you on the other side.
So dark, you couldn't feel the
light. I love you, and I really miss you.
Reaching for you through that stormy cloud. Now here we are, gathered.
I could play with.
In our little hometown.
Yeah, now she pulls hair a lot.
Can't be the way.
What's her name?
Avery. To draw a crowd. Oh, I. That's what I keep asking, was there anything I could have said or done? Oh, I had no clue you were masking a troubled soul. God only knows what went wrong. And stage in the middle of a song. Now in my mind I keep you frozen as a 17-year-old, round and third to score the played with passion, no matter what the game. When you took the stage, you shined just like the sun. Oh, I, that's what I keep asking. And was there anything? clue you were masking a troubled soul. Oh, God only knows what went wrong and why you leave the stage in the middle.